I'm Jeff Yarger. I'm a professor of chemistry, biochemistry, and physics at Arizona State University. I'd like to introduce a basic topic in electrochemistry or biological redox chemistry today. And I want to start by reminding us of Gibbs free energy, because really what I want to make is a relationship to how general the field of electrochemistry is to biological and chemical processes. So the Gibbs free energy is used most commonly in chemistry and biochemistry because it's the form of energy that we use most commonly when we're doing chemistry or reactions or changes in the number of moles and stuff. And we often look at it, so again, I always, you know, start from the same point, the combined first second law, which tells us how the internal energy of a system changes, right? But we often want to get into the natural variables that are more conducive for chemistry, and that's often under constant temperature and pressure conditions. Then we can look at it in a sense what's often called the extra work or the non-mechanical work, which is really what I think of as the chemical work in the system. When we're doing any type of chemistry, we're changing things around, right? And so we define the Gibbs energy as U plus PV, which is also H, is defined as the enthalpy, minus TS. And then by doing a Legendre transform, it gives from what I think of as the combined first second law of thermodynamics to the most fundamental, you know, relationship for the Gibbs energy. However, this is typically the starting point for getting the Gibbs energy in a form that we use, but it's rarely, you know, the form we use itself. In fact, you know, like I said, most commonly we'll do things at constant temperature and pressure, and in a sense look at how the number of moles are changing. And today we're really gonna get a better handle on this parameter, the chemical potential of the system. So, and what I would say is I like to summarize the Gibbs energy in two ways. There's two, you know, ways that I think of manipulating this that we use most commonly when we look at the Gibbs energy. One is here, which is we say that, you know, G is equal to H, you know, minus TS. And so if we take the change in this at a constant temperature, then we can get, you know, this formula out. And this is used very commonly in chemistry and biochemistry, where we often split up where, you know, we define whether something is reactive or not, or whether something's spontaneous or not, by whether, you know, the Gibbs free energy is positive, the change in Gibbs free energy is positive or negative, right? And we often think about this in terms of you know, enthalpy, which is kind of heat or the useful energy available in the system, and then the entropy, which is, you know, the energy loss due to disorder or entropy messiness in the system, right, that we subtract away and say, you know, how much, you know, useful energy do we have? Do we have any useful energy to do chemical work or reactivity, you know, in a system, right? And so we use this all the time looking at it, right? We also, you know, when we're looking at not just whether reactions happen or not and kind of what, you know, different forms of energy are going into it, we often look at it also from this standpoint, from this chemical work term, and, you know, derive a way of looking at the Gibbs free energy, which I would say is during a reaction. You can look at the reaction quotient, right? We're often looking at it, though, because it's path independent at the equilibrium state. So, you know, when the delta G is zero, when it stopped reacting, and then this delta G zero will be minus this RT ln of, now it's, we give that reaction quotient when it's at equilibrium, you know, a special symbol, we call it K, the equilibrium constant. And so we often use delta G in either this form, you know, when we're looking at reactivity, or this form most commonly when we're looking at how this reactivity, if it's spontaneous or not, and where the different types of energy are going. And this equilibrium constant or reaction quotient, when you're not at equilibrium, the ratio of these tells you whether you're still reacting. And you know, once you get to equilibrium though, this equilibrium constant tells you something about the concentrations or the number of moles, you know, of each component. And that's what we're doing in biochemistry or chemistry. You know, we're changing those, and we want to know where they're, you know, at equilibrium or what those changes have done that minimize the energy of the system, right? So that just gives us a brief overview. Now, the reason I do that is because there's such a fundamental relation between the Gibbs free energy, which we use for almost all kind of classical thermodynamics to look at reaction and equilibria and how things are changing in chemistry and biochemistry. And then oftentimes electrochemistry or redox chemistry, reduction oxidation reaction, gets treated almost like a separate subject. When in reality, almost everything we do in chemistry and biochemistry can be phrased in this terminology, because really at its core, electrochemistry or redox, reduction oxidation, is really just asking, is there a change, you know, in the electrons, in the, you know, are you, you know, in a reaction, you know, moving electrons around? And if so, then oftentimes one of the easiest ways to look at this is by, if you're moving electrons around, then you know, you're gonna be able to look at this in terms of, you know, voltage, in terms of current, which is electrons moving, etc. And so it's often this terminology that we use most commonly to actually look at measurements in system. And I point, you know, like I said, the two that we use most commonly, which is this or knowing that, you know, when delta G is zero, that this will be minus RT ln of K, right? As we've written here, you know, this looks eerily similar to if we just, you know, take these and look at it in terms of a potential difference. In fact, it's almost implied in what we talked about before, which is this is related, you know, the molar free energy is related to, you know, the chemical potential and some ideal chemical potential state, right? Chemical potential, a potential difference, a voltage difference across things. And so the Nernst equation is, in a sense, the electrochemical equivalent with the same equilibrium constant, the same reaction quotient that we use when we're doing normal chemistry or biochemistry reactions. Except this one is, you know, looking at things, you know, from its change in potential. And so now, instead of looking at things in kilojoules per mole and keeping track of these concentrations, we're looking at things in voltages. So we're looking at just how the electrons are changing. And if you think about it at its heart of heart, this is really what we're almost always doing in chemistry or biochemistry. If you think of any reaction that you almost write down, what's changing? It's not the nucleus, right? You're typically not, you know, you're typically just moving electrons around in chemistry. You know, most of chemistry is just related to pushing electrons around and causing them to push into bonds, causing them to move one place or another to maybe make something an ion or make something back to neutral, right? To make covalent bonds or ionic bonds, to push electrons from one atom over to another, et cetera. But I mean, that almost defines what we mean by doing a reaction. So almost everything we do in chemistry and biochemistry can be done in this way. And most of modern measurements are done through, because of the sensitivity of being able to measure things electronically, we often practically measure things electrochemically. So really what we've always talk about in kind of introductory chemistry and biochemistry, looking at reactions as far as its free energy, or useful work in a system. And we know that, you know, that gives us a relationship to equilibrium constant, or in a sense, the concentration or the number of moles, you know, that are changing and where they are in equilibrium. And now this gives us, you know, we can basically go from the free energy directly into the electromotive force, or the change in potential across the system, right? If we're doing it, you know, reversibly, we can take that kind of change in potential and we call it the electromotive force then. And from the electromotive force, we can go to the equilibrium constant. So really this gives us a path for almost everything we look at as far as free energy under constant temperature or pressure conditions to be able to look at this in electrochemical terms. So just to give you, you know, a quick sense of what I think is a very useful thing to do is basically to look at the fundamental equations we use for Gibbs free energy versus the Nernst equations, and work sets of problems using kind of both. And so, you know, they're very, you know, what I would say obvious ones, like, you know, acid-base chemistry. These are where ions, where it's very obvious because you have, you know, H pluses, OH minuses. So it's obvious, you know, these are referring to ions basically having, you know, changing electronic states or moving an electron on or off to create ions, right? So that's a fairly obvious one where what we've been doing to date, looking at Gibbs energy, equilibrium constants, pKa's, et cetera, you can couch in electrochemical terms, putting everything in terms of its potential difference. And we usually use it, again, just like with energy, where we have to define a state and then it's always the change in energy that we're looking at. It's the same here. We define a reference system, usually hydrogen, hydrogen ion, hydrogen gas, hydrogen ion, as 0 volts, and then we make everything relative to that. And so you can recouch everything by looking at its change in potential or change in voltages across systems. To a little less obvious one, like colligative properties, like solubility, stuff where we can look at the concentrations of these of where something would be, right? And so, like, let's take the first one, like pH. Like, what are we talking about measurement-wise here? Well, classically, if we wanted to do something like the pH, we might do, you know, a titration, you know, to look at, you know, the pH of a system. Now, what you can do is just set it up in an electrochemical cell with respect to an electrode, so, and watch the electrochemistry to get the pH instead of something like the titration. Solubility, instead of putting things into solution and seeing where you start getting precipitate come out to know where the limit of solubility is, again, you can set up an electrochemical cell and not even have to reach the precipitation point, just to be able to electrochemically deposit from a half cell to another to get what the at the solubilities of things. To even the most basic of all reactions, I would say, you know, probably what the first reaction you ever see in chemistry or biochemistry, you know, hydrogen and oxygen, you know, gas, you know, and, you know, say going to form, you know, liquid water, you know. You know, and a lot of times I write something so simple just to remind us that oftentimes even what we think of as, you know, because we're not showing ions here at all or anything about the electrons directly, but that is at the heart of what you're doing, is you're changing, you're moving electrons in the system, right? You're changing where the electrons, you know, are from being localized on hydrogen and oxygen to having bonds between hydrogen and oxygen, covalent bonds between them in water, etc. And so we can get it, you know, obviously free energies here by looking at, you know, enthalpies, formation enthalpies, and entropies, you know, for this process to get at free energies, right? But we can also do this electrochemically. You know, this is about as practical as it gets. We, you know, hydrogen and oxygen is at its most fundamental, one of the most fundamental combustion reactions, right? It's how, you know, it's how we think of oftentimes, you know, the space shuttle going up, you know, et cetera. We use that combustion reaction a lot. It's a much cleaner source than something like coal or gasoline is, as you burn hydrogen and oxygen directly to produce water vapor. As being one of the classic type of chemical reactions, which we can you can obviously already imagine. It's very exothermic. The free energy is very negative in this reaction. You can also do it electrochemically. So we think of that as, you know, a fuel cell. So we can set up you know, a fuel cell to react hydrogen and oxygen to form water as well, and vice versa, the splitting up. We use electrochemistry all the time to split water back into this. So you can look at it electrochemically through its potentials or voltages needed for these reactions that you can measure as well. In fact, I would say it's a very good lesson to look at this this type of reaction and look at it classically as a combustion reaction, you know, and so using this as, for example, you know, hydrogen cars, you know, right? Like a hydrogen power to, you know, power your car, a clean source of combustion for normal combustion engine cars versus, you know, a different way of more or less doing the same thing, which is a fuel cell to use hydrogen and oxygen to create water. And you can do this now at, you know, much lower temperatures. So, you know, do something, you know, a fuel cell at much lower temperatures and look at, you know, these reactions. In a sense, it'll give you a sense of how the delta G changes as a function of temperature in a system. So I hope this very general introduction to electrochemistry will help bridge between what we do in kind of classical biochemistry or chemical thermodynamics and electrochemistry or redox or ion thermodynamics, and where we're going to be motivating, re-looking at a lot of processes we've already done, but from the standpoint of measuring potentials instead of, you know, looking at the energies directly. Thank you.